Y'all ready?
Will everybody come in and find your place? I was telling the choir that when I came this morning to church, I didn't know if I'd have enough energy and strength to go through the morning service. I went home and my wife said, "How are you doing?" And I said, "I have had some awfully good medicine this morning." And it wasn't just something, a pill the doctor gave me. It was this choir and this preaching that I've had today. What a sermon. What a sermon. How are you compared to God's plumb line? Powerful, powerful sermon. We're going to sing for you tonight. Are you ready? Okay, here goes. Pastor said something this morning that kind of stuck with me, and as I was getting these songs together, he talked about people that come to church wearing masks, and I really thought a lot about that, you know, and I'm sure I've been one of those people sometimes. We just put on the good front, you know, when really on the inside we're totally different. And I thought of this song because it says, burdens are lifted at Calvary. We can take all those things that are within us and we can just leave it with Christ.
Amen. Burdens are lifted. Yes, we can.
Thank you.
You know, Brother Kenneth loves this song, Come Morning. And, you know, there's a lot of struggle and grief in this world, but I love this song because it says, Come Morning, Pastor. There's a day coming. Come Morning. There's a wonderful old hymn called Learning to Lean, and I find myself in that category so often. I try to do it on my own. You know, I can work this out, you know, and I realize that without the Lord Jesus Christ, I just cause confusion within myself. But this song says, I'm learning to lean.
We open with the chorus, okay?
Learning to lean. since I found His peace so serene. He helps me with each task, if only I'll ask. Every day now I'm learning to lean.
Learning to lean, learning to lean. I'm learning to lean on Jesus, finding more power than I'd ever dreamed. I'm learning to
I don't like to get too far away from my cane. I get antsy when it's not near me. I thought of old Job, and no one in the Bible had more, I guess, disaster befall him than Job. But you know, through it all, even his wife and his friends didn't give him any support. He still said, "I'd rather have Jesus." And that's the name of this song, 550. If you would stand with us, we'd like to do this before the choir comes down. And I don't know about you, but I'd rather have Jesus than anything else I can think of.
I'd rather have Jesus than sin.
I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide.
choir's coming down, be sure and fellowship. Tell somebody you love them. Brother Buck, I love you.
Welcome you back to the Sunday evening service, and hope you've had a wonderful evening. I think I went to tuck a little nap in my chair this afternoon. How many of you know many times you take that little nap and you wake up worse, feeling worse than you did before you took it? So, I feel like my get up and go got up and gone. I guess at my age, I'm supposed to feel that way, right? But good to see you back tonight. Let me encourage you ladies, tomorrow evening, as you gather to pray. Somebody said, what can we do? We can all pray. If you can't pray, get to the place and get somewhere and get along with God until you can get to the place you can pray. And Wednesday night, Romans chapter 2. The sinfulness of man in his lost condition. Religious but lost. Romans chapter 2, Wednesday night. And then, Lord's willing, I'm probably preaching the next two Sundays. Now, it's not concrete, but I feel I have leadership right now from the Lord. Next two Sundays, I'll be preaching from the book of Amos. Amen. What a book. It stirred my heart. Man, I tell you, here's this fella down there picking his sycamore fruit, wild figs, taking care of his herd. God comes down and tells him, hey, I want you to go up to Bethel, and I got a message for you to preach. I don't find nowhere that old Amos argued or debated. He said, okay, God, you call me, I'm going. He goes up there. They run him out of town. He went up to the fuss church. He called them women heifers. He went up to the fuss church, and he rocked their boat. And the old priest come out and said, buddy, you need to get out of town. He said, all right, I'll get out of town, but I've already delivered God's message, and you're going to have to deal with what God said to you. Amen. How many of you know they didn't listen to God's plumb line? You read the book of Amos. Boy, what a book, little book of Amos. Get to the next little book. Boy, I tell you, those minor prophets, what a study, what a study. So be praying, and Ladies, again, remember, we need you to help us with the pastor's fellowship luncheon on the 14th of June. We got 50 to 60 preachers. We need you to prepare lunch for them. Did you ever see 50 or 60 preachers eat? Amen. So we have our Tri-State Baptist Fellowship once a month, and it is here the 14th of June at Oakland. So, ladies, if you'd help us with that, we sure would appreciate it. If our men come, we'll receive the evening giving. You give as the Lord has blessed and prospered you. Amen. What are we getting ready to do? When's the happiest time I'm supposed to be in the church? Hey, how many of you remember the message this morning? Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. We get to give now. Brother Wiley, would you pray for us? Yes.
Father, we just thank you for your goodness and for your mercy. Father, I pray that you bless us all and may you bring honor and glory to your name. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Corinthians chapter 16, verse 13 through 16. 1 Corinthians. Matter of fact, the first part of this chapter is talking about giving, receiving the collection. And he said, give as God has prospered you. Verse 13 through verse 16 for a scripture reading in our text for the evening's message on how to make life count for the Lord Jesus Christ. How to make your life count for the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't that sound like a good subject? How to make your life count for the Lord Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 16, verse 13, follow with me as I read in your hearing. Watch ye, stand fast in the faith. Quiet you like men, be strong. Let all your things be done with charity, love. I beseech, I beg you, brethren, you know the house of Stephanas, that it is the first fruit of Achaia, and that they have addicted themselves to the ministry of the saints. That you submit yourselves unto such, and to every one that helpeth with us and laboreth. How to make your life count for the Lord Jesus Christ. I don't know about you. I feel I've come too far to be a castaway.
Amen.
I feel like I've come too far to turn back. All of these many years contending for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. But I want to finish well. And I want my life to really count for the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't you? Let's pray and ask God to help us from this text tonight. Father, we thank you for the word of God that we've read. And I make my confession tonight, I've not read man's word, but I've read the word of God. And Father, we're in desperate need to hear what you've got to say. I'm afraid today we're listening to too many other voices instead of what God has to say to us. But I pray tonight, Lord, you'll just help us to tune out all those statical things that's interfering tonight, and they just get out of the way for a few moments, and we'd get zeroed in with 100% reception into our minds and hearts and spirit about the truth that you have for us tonight in this message, making our lives count for the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we're running this race. We're going to finish our course one day, and we're going to stand at the bema seat of Christ, and we're going to give account. And help us, Lord, to be faithful stewards as we run this race. In Jesus Christ's name we ask and pray. Amen. And amen. Making your life count for the Lord Jesus Christ. A lot of times I throw a challenge out to you, don't I? As far as I know, you never have taken one of them. Amen. If you've took them, we ain't done too much of it with them, oh, have we? But I just stop and think this evening, a challenge of this coming week. What if in this coming week, if every one of us left church tonight with a God-given vision burning in our heart? What does the Bible say? Without a vision, the people what? Perish. That word vision literally means hope. Without a hope. Without a hope. What if we left here tonight with a hope, believing that we could really make a difference and our lives could count for the cross of Christ? You know, one of the reasons, and I had a lot of you think, well, I'm insignificant. I don't have a great education, and I don't have this, and I don't have a great personality, and I don't have this, and I don't have that. You know what God's looking for? He's looking for weak vessels that he can glorify himself through them. Did any of you ever hear about Mr. Dummy over in Unicoi County? I know some of you think everybody's dummies over there, but did any of you ever hear about Mr. Dummy over in Unicoi County in Irwin? This story was brought to me several years ago, and I found out that it is a true story. I don't know if any of you remember going out of Irwin, going up the old highway that we have to wander up the mountain going to Sounds Gap to Asheville, North Carolina. I don't know if you remember going up that crooked road going up to Sam's Gap, and you got about three quarters up the mountain, and there was a little Baptist brick church that sat in one of the big curves down below the road. Any of you ever remember seeing that little brick Baptist church? The story goes is Mr. Dummy, he couldn't speak back in that day and time. If you couldn't speak or you couldn't talk, you were called deaf and dumb. And this man could not talk, he could not speak, and he could not hear. But that little church was having a revival. And some folks got burdened for this man that couldn't speak and couldn't talk, and everybody called him Dummy. And they got burdened for him, got to praying for him, and they got him to started coming to the revival. And matter of fact, he came in and he'd sat right up next to the front. He'd been there for several nights, over and over he'd been coming. And one night that the invitation was given, and he just fell in the altar and he began to moan. He couldn't talk and he couldn't hear. And they said, how are we going to communicate to him how to be saved? I promise you, if the heart is hungry for God, it was something that God used to open that man's heart of his word some way, somehow. and God got a hold of his heart. He came and hungry to know the true and the living God. And they dealt with him the best that they know how, of pointing and sign and all. And they really didn't have sign language or anything. They didn't know how. But they did the best that they knew how that night to try to lead old dummy to the Lord. And they wondered. I wonder if he really got saved. And people left the church at night. I wonder if he really got saved. The next day, he lived on down from the church there in another one of those big old curves that cut. We called them what? Switchbacks. And he lived in another one of them down below the church. And they saw old dummy out there and had his axe and had his saw and had his mowing scythe. And he was cleaning the hillside off. People couldn't understand, what in the world is dummy doing? He's out there cleaning the hillside off, and he's getting everything off. And he got it cleaned off, and where it was, you'd come around the curve, and when you come around that curve, you come face into that hillside where he cleaned off. And they kept watching him. And old dummy went and got him some big old long poles, and he put him a cross, a big old cross on the side of that hill. And this is what old dummy did then. He couldn't talk, he couldn't speak, he couldn't hear, but he took a Bible and he stood out in the middle of the road and he was holding that Bible and he was pointing to the cross. He was and they said literally hundreds of people got saved because of what old dummy did. If God can use him, don't you think he could use you and me? Don't you think that God could use you and me if we got a heart to do something for the glory? What if we got a vision this week, a burden to go out into the highway? What if we really walked out of here tonight with a faith burning in our heart that God is able, God's big enough, and God still can send revival? Up in Kentucky, a revival has broke out. Ronnie that was here yesterday morning, I'd heard a little bit about it. In this one county there in the high schools, 1,600 teenagers have been saved, and it's still going on. And it's spreading through to other counties and all, and it's just going from church to church up in Kentucky there. Hey, I believe God can still send revival where people want revival, where people get a hunger and thirst. What if we walked out of here this evening with a faith, believe that God is able and God can? Can God? God can. Can God? God can. If we walked out of here with a vision and with a heart to really see what God could do this week, what if we began to work? You know, faith without works is what? Dead. We can go out and say, well, I believe that God can, but God wants some workmen to go out there and minister. Is this verse, the verses that we've read here tonight, that we might get addicted to the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. And here's something very important. If we went out with enthusiasm and a passion, enthusiasm. Did anybody hear about enthusiasm? If we had some enthusiasm, hey, I'll say it again, if we were enthusiastic and excited about going to heaven, we might get somebody interested in going with us. Amen? Now, how to make our lives count for the Lord Jesus Christ. Our text here that we've read tonight, if you'll turn, I had moved there, in 1 Corinthians chapter 16 and verse number 13, he says, watch ye, stand fast in the faith, quiet you like men, and be what? Strong. I mean strong. I mean courageous, not willing to bend, not willing to back up, not willing to compromise, but willing to be strong in the Lord. So how am I going to make my life count for the Lord Jesus Christ? I believe, first of all, I'm going to have to make a deliberate commitment of my life to Him.
Amen.
Turn to the book of Romans just a moment. Romans chapter 12, a very familiar portion of Scripture. One that I wished that we would get real familiar with. Romans chapter 12 and verse 1. 1 and 2 I'm going to read. Make a deliberate commitment of your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, Paul, when he met the Lord on the Damascus Road in Acts 9, 6, he said, Lord, what would thou have me to do? And I believe Paul made a commitment there to fulfill the will of God for his life. Look at what Romans 12, 1 and 2 says. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, I beg you, my brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. I believe it's the will of God we commit ourselves to His Lordship. I believe it's the will of God that we surrender our all to Him. I'm reminded of what Proverbs 3 says. Commit thy ways unto the Lord and lean not unto thy own understanding. Commit. How many of you know we'll do very little until we make a commitment? Has anybody noticed I can button my coat now? Has anybody noticed my wife? What has Pat and Pastor Yelton made a commitment to do? Not to eat. I ain't had no banana pudding so long. Why did somebody have to mention it? I ain't had nothing good in so long. Why did you have to mention it? I promise you, you won't do something until you make a commitment to do it. That's just like to get out there and to walk every day. I mean, listen, I'm telling you, it's hard. But I will only do it as I make a what? Hey, that carries over in the spiritual realm, church. We will not be spiritually what we should be until we make a commitment to be what God would have us to be. And here He tells us to give ourselves, to commit our bodies unto Him, our reasonable service, and get into the Word of God and have our minds changed and transformed and renewed that we might be committed to the perfect will of God. If my life is going to count for the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm going to have to make a deliberate commitment. David Brainerd made a deliberate commitment to reach the Indians many years ago. David Livingston made a commitment to go to Africa to preach the gospel to the black man. Hudson Taylor made a commitment to go to China to win the masses to the Lord Jesus Christ. David Burnham made a commitment to go to New Guinea to win the people to the Lord Jesus Christ. And everybody that's ever done anything for the cause of Christ with God-given eternal values has first of all had to make a commitment. Commit yourself unto the Lord. Give yourself unto the Lord. Commit yourself to the Lord and see God work mightily in your life. Secondly, how's my life going to count for the Lord Jesus Christ? A commitment, a deliberate commitment of my life, my body, my all to Him. But secondly, I'm going to have to abandon my life for His glory. I'm going to have to abandon my life for His glory. How many knows what that means? That means I've got to come to the end of myself that He might have total control of my life. Where is the glory of God in Christendom? in the life that is full of Him. How many of you know the only thing that makes you a Christian is Christ in you, the hope of glory? If any of you ever heard this saying, maybe some of you new people that's come never heard this. A person trying to be a Christian is like a cat trying to be a dog. Now sink that in a minute. I talk to people, I say, are you a Christ? Well, I'm trying to be. Stop! You can't be a Christian trying to be a Christian. What's the only thing that makes you a Christian? Christ in you. And see, when I'm filled of Him and full of Him and He's sitting on the throne of my life, then whose life is being manifested through my life? Whose glory is being revealed? Hey, folks, listen, you've heard me say it many times. When we come to church, we see a monstrosity. We see the body without the head. We're the body, but He's the head. We need to see Jesus and His glory and manifestation. By the way, how many of you know when the pressures of life gets on, who's ever sitting on the throne of your life will be manifested in your actions? If Christ is sitting there, He will come forth. But if old self is there, old self will come forth. So if I'm going to make a difference for the cause of Christ and my life count for Him, I'm going to have to abandon my will to His will. How many times through the Bible does it talk about not my will, but His will? How many is praying, not my will, but God's will be done? Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, he's praying before he goes to the cross, and finally he says, Father, not my will, but your will be done. We've got to abandon our will to His will. We've got to come to that place that we are totally surrendered to Him and His Lordship and say, Lord, here, take control of my life and fill me. How many of you know we have very little preaching on the Lordship of Jesus Christ anymore? We have all this self-help, prosperity stuff, junk that's preached today, and what we can do and the marvelous miracles and the powers and the glory. It's nothing except pure humanism. We need to return to be totally surrendered unto Him and all abandonment. Thirdly, if my life is going to make a difference for the cause of the Lord Jesus Christ, if it's going to count for the Lord Jesus Christ, then I'm going to have to burn my bridges behind me. This is the way a lot of us Christians live. We're going down the pathway of serving the Lord and wanting to serve the Lord, and all of a sudden God calls us to do something. Instead of burning our bridges behind us, we still leave them open. Well, may it might not work out, so I'll leave an opening. Hey, if your life's going to count for God, you better burn the bridges behind you that you can't return and start relying upon man and the flesh and somebody else to take care of you. In these many years of serving the Lord, I've had to burn some bridges behind me. God saved me, God called me to preach, and I was working in Tennessee Eastman. I took all 3 weeks of my vacation to go preach on Sunday. 3 weeks vacation ran out, and I kept praying, oh, God, do this, God, do this, God, do this. You know what I was wanting to do? I was wanting to hang on to that wonderful job at Tennessee Eastman I had. And I realized God had called me to preach and God called me to the ministry. And I walked into Dave Stokely's office and I said, Mr. Stokely, 2 weeks from today, which is Friday, I give Eastman 2 weeks notice of my resignation. 2 weeks from Friday is my last day at Tennessee Eastman. He said, Roy, don't you know what in the world we have done? There's never been nobody promoted. Don't you understand what we've got in store for you? Don't you understand you're going to be superintendent of building 226? And he went down and all. I said, Mr. Stokely, let me make it clear. If you give me Tennessee Eastman, 2 days from today, 2 weeks from today is my last day. He said, where in the world are you going? Is another company hard you? I said, no, God saved me and called me to preach. He said, you'll starve to death. What have I been trying to do? Ooh, glory to God. Huh? I had to burn a bridge that day. And I had to burn it till I couldn't go back if things didn't go the way that I wanted them to do. Hey, listen. You're going to have to know what God wants you to do. You're going to have to set your face like a flint towards it. And you got to march on. Yes, there's been in these many years of following the Lord, preaching, being a pastor, and preaching across the country and all. There's been a many a time, boy, I would like to turn around and went back, but they wasn't nowhere to turn around and go back. The only thing I could do was keep pressing on. Amen. Hey, if your life's going to count for the Lord Jesus Christ, you're going to have to burn the bridges behind you. The Lord said, as you put your hands to the plow, what did he say to keep doing? Keep plowing until what? What did he say? If you look back, and turn back. He said, you're not what? Fit for the what? The kingdom of God. What's God saying? When you put your life in the ministry of the Lord God Almighty for the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ, there's no place to quit. There's no place to back up. There's no place to regress. What's the only thing you're supposed to keep doing? Have you noticed today? There's a lot of people quitting. Have you noticed today? There's a lot of people turning back. Have you noticed today? There's a lot of people turning loose of the plow. Have you noticed today? There's a lot of people going the wrong direction. Amen. If I'm going to make my life count for the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm going to have to make a deliberate commitment of my life to Him. I'm going to have to abandon my life for the cause of Christ. I'm going to have to burn my bridges behind me. And fourthly, I can't get sidetracked. How many times have I saw people get saved and start serving God and get sidetracked? How many times have I saw somebody get in there and serving the Lord and honoring the Lord and growing in the grace and knowledge of God and being faithful, and all of a sudden they got what? Sidetracked. Yeah. Folks, I'm going to tell you something. Missing church just one or two Sundays can get you sidetracked and get you away from where you ought to be. The devil don't want to keep you on, don't want you to stay on the straight and narrow way. The devil don't want you to keep pressing on for the glory of God. He's going to do everything he can to get you sidetracked. He'll use discouragement. He'll use people. He'll use anything. He'll use entertainment. He'll use pleasure. He'll use things. He'll use anything that he can use to get you distracted and get you sidetracked. Can I ask a question? I want to ask it anyway. What do you think in the last 50 years an instrument that came into our homes that keep many of us distracted from the Word of God. I did have my hearing aid on. What's it called?
TV.
A TV. And I plead guilty. I've got so sick of politics, though, that I've just about quit to watching the TV.
Amen.
I mean, if you watch that junk, I guarantee you, you'll get regurgitated. You say, what's that? You'll vomit. You'll puke.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
But I promise you, there's all kinds of distractions out there to keep you from pressing on for the glory of God, to get your mind thinking about other things, to get your attention on things that's not God glorifying, little by little, and we get distracted. And it don't take long, folks, to get in a state of complacency and apathy and indifference in our spiritual walk with the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, listen, we can get sidetracked there. And then fifthly, if my life is going to count for the Lord Jesus Christ, it's going to have to be a life of service. It's going to have to be a life that lives for others. Any of you ever read about the Salvation Army? Who founded the Salvation Army? William Booth. William Booth had a great burden to reach souls for the Lord Jesus Christ, and the people in poverty and the people that didn't have none of the things of this world and all, and they lived in poverty and just was in horrible shape, and William Booth began to minister to these people. He began to provide them with means of enablement to work and get into housing and get their clothing and get their food and all. And William Booth had the mindset that he loved others more than he loved himself. He desired to help someone else more than he desired to help himself. And William Booth went out and founded the Great Salvation Army. William Booth was an old man at the point, very sick and at the point of death. And the Salvation Army was having their yearly conference. And the message was sent to William Booth, would you write a letter to the delegates of the Salvation Army at our yearly convention? Would you write a letter and let us read it at the convention? Hundreds of people were gathered from all over the world. And the man went to the podium and opened the letter from William Booth to read. And he opened it up and it had one word. How many of you know what that one word was? Others. I'm too selfish. I'm too self-centered. I think too much of me. And a lot of times I let my fellow man. If my brother comes to me and says I'm in need, and I say, bless you, brother, I'll pray for you, be on your way, and I have no compassion for my brethren, how dwelleth the love of God in you? If my life is going to count for the Lord Jesus Christ, it's going to have to be lived for others. The ministry of helping others. Lastly, if my life is going to count for him, I must crown him Lord of all. Whatsoever I do, do it all to the glory of God. I must crown him as Lord. What does that mean? He's boss. He's potentate. He's the one that's in charge. I must come to that place and rightly crown him Lord of Lords and Kings of Kings of my life, that he might have the preeminence in and through my life. Heads are bowed. Eyes are closed.